I don't know if you've spotted this in your news feed at all, but there was a change of administration in the United States earlier this year. The new chap at the top seems quite keen to eradicate pretty much all the policies enacted by his predecessor to make way for his own very different and rather radical agenda. Apparently, it's causing a bit of a kerfuffle. Two of the policy portfolios being targeted most enthusiastically are the climate and environment and the green energy transition. The new administration says environmentalists are being far too alarmist about the consequences of a rapidly warming planet and that the cost of mitigating that warming is far too high, placing an unacceptable brake on economic growth. They say there's no point in America decarbonising its energy system anyway, when the two most populous countries, China and India, are still pumping out huge quantities of greenhouse gases from all their coal-fired power stations. They say we're much better off keeping our existing energy systems and deploying innovations like carbon capture and storage to keep emissions out of the atmosphere or direct air capture to suck existing gases back out. And they say we must also now accept the warming that's coming and learn how to adapt and be more resilient to changing climatic conditions. So I've had a bit of a think about that. Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. Those five objections to climate policies that I touched on just now are, according to many environmental analysts, the classic straw man arguments of the climate denial machine sponsored and supported almost entirely by the multi-billionaires who control the global fossil fuel industry. You can read about all of them in vivid detail in this superb book by Genevieve Gunter, which I've linked in the description below. But let's take a quick look at them here. The so-called climate skeptics argue that all this talk about catastrophic climate risks is just overexcited environmentalists being alarmist. There's no significant risk to human society, they tell us, and we're certainly not on track for any existential consequences like the extinction of the entire human race. So let's have a think about that. We saw in a recent video that as early as the end of 2026, the world is likely to have entered a new climate regime with global surface temperatures in the following two decades averaging more than 1.5 degrees higher than pre-industrial times. So that's the more ambitious target of the 2015 Paris Agreement out the window for a start. What about the slightly less ambitious target of 2 degrees Celsius? Well, according to the United Nations 2024 Emissions Gap Report, if all the nationally declared legally binding climate mitigation policies of all the nations that have signed up to the Paris Treaty were enacted perfectly, in full, and to the letter, which very few of them actually are right now, but if they were, then within the average expected lifetime of a child born today, the world they inhabit will have warmed by around 3 degrees Celsius compared to pre-industrial levels. Now, of course, we could make a whole video about the global effects of 3 degrees Celsius of surface temperature warming, and indeed I have done that on several occasions over the years. But let's just focus on the good old US of A, where arguably the largest contingent of anti-climate policy lobbying takes place. In her book, The Language of Climate Politics, Genevieve Gunter references data from the IPCC's Sixth Climate Assessment Report, or AR6, published in 2023, and she explains that 3 degrees Celsius of global heating would likely mean that for around 3 months of the year, the entire East Coast all the way to Maine, the Midwest to the Great Plains, and half of California would be so hot that being outdoors would put you at risk of death. Southern California, the Southwest, the Deep South, and Florida would be this deadly hot for nearly half the year. Now, those things might not represent species extinction level events, but they certainly sound a little bit existentially threatening to me. And we're starting to feel it even now, aren't we? In 2021, just as one example, British Columbia experienced 3 straight days with temperatures above 49 degrees Celsius or 121 degrees Fahrenheit, more than 22 degrees Celsius or 40 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than average. An event which, according to public health officials, caused almost 1,000 deaths in British Columbia. Being alarmed by the world we're currently leaving to our kids and grandkids doesn't make you an alarmist. It makes you a realist. And here's the even more alarming realisation now dawning on our climate scientists. The way our planet is responding right now, even to comparatively low levels of warming of about 1.3 degrees Celsius, appears to be corresponding with the upper end of the so-called range of uncertainty that those scientists have to apply to their data. It's not that the scientists have been wrong about their numbers. In fact, scientific predictions of planetary warming for a given level of greenhouse gas emissions have been pretty much spot on. Now, it's just that the scientific community has historically been predisposed to offering the most conservative commentary possible about the consequences of those temperature increases, precisely for fear of being accused of alarmism. Well, now it looks like Mother Nature is starting to provide us with the real answers. So what about cost then? Well, this is all about estimating the financial impact of the economy of making all the changes necessary to stay within safe warming limits and setting that number against the cost to society of dealing with the consequences of not staying within those safe limits. Not just the obvious stuff like cleaning up and rebuilding critical infrastructure after extreme weather events, but also the impact of those events on things like food chain supply security, or reductions in the number of hours that manual labourers can work outside, or the cost of migration across borders and even within a nation, as we're already seeing with population movements in the United States. And then there's increased pressure on healthcare systems, not just from heat-related illnesses, but also from waterborne disease vectors that migrate from the equator towards the poles alongside warmer and wetter conditions. Not to mention regional and wider conflicts over increasingly scarce resources. I could go on, but you get the idea. The argument put forward by the climate skeptics is that the cost of rapidly transforming our energy systems, eliminating the combustion of fossil fuels, addressing the global food production system, and doing all the other stuff necessary to effectively mitigate climate change is far higher than the cost of moving much more slowly and accepting the cost of adapting to a new global climate paradigm. That argument is often based on an economic system called the Dynamic Integrated Climate Economy, or DICE, created by a Yale economist called William Nordhaus in the 1990s. That system suggested that even if the planet warmed by 3 degrees Celsius, it would only have about a 2% impact on global GDP, equivalent to just a single year of economic growth. Surely a price we could afford to pay, so the argument goes. But according to a recent publication by the UK Institute and Faculty of Actuaries, a deeper analysis of the assumptions underpinning this estimate shows that as well as excluding from analysis many of the risks now expected to occur, it also excludes 87% of the economy from the analysis, assuming that a number of sectors will be negligibly affected by climate change. The professional financial risk assessors who underwrite multi-billion dollar insurance policies are now looking towards a much more expensive set of projected economic impacts from a range that starts at the extremely optimistic 2% GDP loss espoused by Nordhaus and goes all the way up to as much as 25% of global GDP lost by mid-century and potentially 50% gone by 2100. So given the higher end climate responses we looked at earlier, is it really responsible to burden our kids and grandkids with such a potentially dystopian future? And by the way, the cost of mitigation right now is actually far lower than even the most optimistic analysts could have ever dreamed of back in the 90s when Nordhaus first formulated his hypothesis. Implementing renewable technologies like wind, solar, and battery energy storage is in many cases the cheapest option available. So even the economics of our modern world stack up rather unfavourably against fossil fuels. A 2020 study from the Goldman School of Public Policy at UC Berkeley found that if America decarbonised its grid 90% by 2035, it would reduce the average family electricity bill by 10% and create an estimated 500,000 new jobs per year. As Genevieve Gunter explains in her book, today, the fastest growing job in America is solar installer. Approximately 472,000 people work in solar and wind industries already, and the clean energy revolution is just getting started. But why bother with all this if India and China are still burning more blah, blah, blah? Well, first of all, what a pathetic cop-out that argument is. Are we sheep? Do we need to wait for another nation to act before we do what we know is the right thing? Is that how it works, really? Here's a useful chart. It shows the world's biggest greenhouse gas emitters. And sure enough, there's China and India and the USA. But here's all the nations that each account for less than 2% of global emissions and those representing less than 1% each. We small emitters should all just not bother anymore then, should we? And continue to be collectively the largest emitter of all? Don't be so daft. And by the way, here's another chart showing greenhouse gas emissions since the Industrial Revolution. So let's be careful who we point the finger at when we're looking for someone to blame for the current climate emergency. And on China specifically, which is the country usually singled out by Western democracies as the great Satan of our time, Let's have a quick look at its coal power capacity, which seems to be the main bone of contention whenever you speak to a why should we bother kind of a person. It is true to say that following a long period of decline in that country's coal industry, suddenly in 2021, China restarted its coal capacity growth like some sort of demonically possessed fossil fuel zealot. As Genevieve Gunter highlights in her book, in that year, the Chinese leadership approved coal-fired power plants equivalent to half of all new capacity across the entire globe. The following year, China issued permits that represented six times as much coal production as the rest of the world put together. And in just the first 3 months of 2023, the CCP permitted more new coal-fired power plants than in the whole of 2021. So what the hell was going on then? Well, basically, blind panic is what was going on. You see, in 2021 and 2022, China suffered devastating heat waves, ironically exacerbated by climate change, and it faced the stark reality that it simply did not have enough energy in those two summers to respond to the crisis, with hydropower drying up in the heat and unprecedented demand for air conditioning among the country's rapidly urbanising population. Two-thirds of all Chinese provinces experienced power blackouts that were literally weeks long. And although no numbers have ever been published, it's highly likely that a large number of people died as a result. The grid infrastructure was not yet in place to really ramp up renewables quickly enough to respond in time. So President Xi and his colleagues had no choice but to switch on the fastest solution, which at that time was China's vast reserves of unused coal. Fast forward to 2025 though, and that grid infrastructure is now largely in place. The renewable energy transition is back on track, and the vast majority of that additional coal capacity is either running at an unprofitable 50% capacity or less, or has been completely mothballed altogether. I've made two or three videos in recent months showing how even such an appalling existential crisis as this has not deterred China from leading the way on the green transition. By 2022, the People's Republic was producing half of all the world's electric vehicles and was generating as much power just from wind and solar as the total power production of France and Germany combined. In 2023, China installed more solar panels in just 1 year than the USA has installed in its entire history. A couple of months ago, I reported that in April of this year, China installed another 45 gigawatts of solar capacity in just 1 month, compared to the 30-odd gigawatts the US installed in the entire previous year. Well, guess what? Just a month later, in May 2025, that record was smashed again when the country installed another 93 gigawatts worth. These are eye-watering numbers, and again, I could go on and on, but you get the idea. China is no paragon of virtue, of course. It is a ruthlessly efficient authoritarian state with a very questionable human rights record and some extremely unpalatable and opportunistic trade deals now in place to import cheap oil and gas from the likes of Russia and Saudi Arabia. But to Xi Jinping, these are nothing more than a transactional means to an end. His stated medium and long-term mission for the country is to reach peak emissions by 2030, a goal which many believe China is on track to achieve far earlier, and to reach net zero emissions by 2060 at the latest. A mission statement that, according to Genevieve Gunter, has now been integrated into every aspect of Chinese governance. In January 2021, the People's Bank of China announced that it would comprehensively factor climate change into its policy framework. These are not idle words. In Chinese culture, they actually mean something. President Xi's Comprehensive National Economic and Energy Action Plan states the goal to peak carbon dioxide emissions permeates the whole process and every aspect of China's economic and social development. We will carry out initiatives to substitute renewable energy for fossil fuels, vigorously develop wind, solar, biomass, marine and geothermal energy sources, among others, and continuously increase the share of non-fossil energy in total energy consumption, prioritising local development and use of wind and solar power. By stark contrast, the United States is now very unlikely to meet its 50 to 52% emissions reduction target by 2030, given the current federal climate policy reversal under President Trump. His first action on day one was to again pull the US out of the Paris Agreement. His administration is actively dismantling key climate regulations, rescinding the EPA's 2009 endangerment finding, rolling back vehicle and power plant emission standards, and revoking methane controls, effectively crippling federal authority to enforce emissions reductions under the Clean Air Act. the Inflation Reduction Act and the bipartisan infrastructure law are facing cuts and legal challenges, undercutting the investment support that was essential to energy transition progress, so that analysts now project well over 40% of required US emissions reductions will remain unachieved by 2030, and the folks at Carbon Brief estimate that this second Trump term is on track to add an additional 7 billion tons of CO2 equivalent to the atmosphere by the end of this decade, compared to the continuation of Biden-era policies. And I could go on, but you get the idea, and this is already turning into an unusually long video. Read the book if you want the whole 200 pages of detail on the language of climate politics. But let's just very quickly finish off with the last two strawman arguments that I highlighted at the start. It probably won't surprise you to learn that both of them are equally spurious. Innovation is essentially just a fossil fuel industry euphemism for carbon capture and storage and carbon dioxide removal technologies like direct air capture. We might eventually need these technologies to some extent to offset the very last few percent of carbon emissions that prove to be virtually impossible to avoid, but we certainly don't need them as a get-out-of-jail-free card to enable fossil fuel producers to carry on business as usual, which is precisely their strategy and the reason why they're pushing these technologies so hard. And resilience is just another way of saying, suck it up, people. The planet is warming already, so get used to it. That sort of rhetoric seeks to absolve the organisations that are causing climate change of any responsibility for radically changing the way they behave, and it places by far the highest burden on the most vulnerable communities. Obviously, we will need adaptation strategies, but according to pretty much all the latest scientific literature, just adaptation alone will simply not be enough without aggressive emission cuts now. So the next time you're down the pub with your mates or whatever the equivalent is in your country, and you get into a heated debate about climate, look out for these telltale strawman objections and do your best to knock them down if you can. And that was pretty much a bit of a rant, wasn't it? Not quite my normal style, but every now and then I read something that reminds me of the truly astonishing levels of BS that the fossil fuel propaganda machine has constructed over the years, and it gets me a bit wound up. So I'm off to take a couple of headache pills now and have a bit of a lie down. And that's it for this week. If you found this video useful and informative, then please do consider subscribing to the channel and clicking on all notifications so that you won't miss any of my weekly episodes. You can also support my weekly workflow by joining the fabulous folks over at patreon.com/justhaveathink, where you'll have the opportunity to vote in content polls, watch early access versions of all my videos, and discuss your thoughts with me on a one-to-one basis via the dedicated chat forum. Most important of all, though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.